Welcome to Jersey Guy Sports, your sports talk home for the Yanks, the Giants, the Rangers, and the Rutgers Scarlet Knights. I'm your host, Don. I want to thank you for listening. Now, today I'm going to be talking about the New York Rangers sweeping the Washington Capitals in round one as they dominated the Caps in all areas. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the Yankees as they bust out and actually score 15 runs in back-to-back games. Finally, let's go ahead and get started. So how about those New York Rangers? The Rangers swept the Washington Capitals 4-0 in round one of the NHL playoffs. And while all of the games were kind of pretty close, as I watched each one of them, I never really felt like the Rangers were kind of completely out of danger in any of them. The Rangers really managed to dominate just about all of the areas in the series. It also never really felt really threatened in the series with the Capitals. The Rangers were clearly the better team in just about all areas, and they really dominated most of the areas. The Rangers were better, for example, on offense. They have more stars, younger stars, faster stars. They have more scoring. They have better depth on offense. They have much better defense than the Capitals do. Particularly, the Rangers have much better goaltending with Igor Shesterkin. The Rangers clearly had better special teams, both on the power play, where they were 37% in the series, including three more power play goals in the clinching game four. The Rangers were better in penalty killing, where they were 88% of 15 of 17. Plus, they ended up with two shorthanded goals on top of the 15 kills. So the Rangers were really better in just about every area. The team's talent gap was really apparent most of the series, at least in my opinion. Individual players, real quickly, Mika was just great in all situations. His gear was sort of questionable leading into the playoffs. Not like he was bad. He certainly is always a responsible defensive player and is usually pretty good on the power play, but his overall offensive game has kind of suffered this year. But in the playoffs, he was just great in every single area. He was really, really, really good. Really, really good. It was a great series to watch Mika Zibanejad fly up and down the ice, dominate on defense, dominate on offense, scoring, assisting. He was just spectacular, as was Trocheck. Vincent Trocheck was awesome everywhere on the ice. And by the way, in addition to playing great defense, checking, scoring in a lot of big situations, he was absolutely great, Trocheck was, on faceoffs, just dominant on faceoffs, which is something the Ranger team this year is very good at, and they have not been good at in past years. It was just a revelation for the Rangers. It's amazing how much better a hockey team is when they can win more faceoffs, especially, as I've said time and time again, in the crucial areas. And that means in your offensive or defensive zones. The ones at center ice, they are what they are. The ones in your offensive or defensive zone are critical to win, and Trocheck's success there has gone a long way this season and so far this postseason into making the Rangers successful. Trocheck was great, as was Mika. You talk about having good centers on your one and two lines. It's hard to imagine better center play than the Rangers got with Mika Zibanejad and Vincent Trocheck. Now, on the other side of the coin, Ovechkin, oh my God, he did not record a point in the whole series. In any of the four games, Ovechkin had 0 points. It was the first time that Ovechkin went pointless in a playoff series his entire career. Now, this isn't some guy who's been playing for 3 years. He's 38, right? He's been playing in the playoffs for, who knows, 15, 18 years at this point. The first time ever that he did not get a point in any of the four games. He had 0 shots on goal in the deciding game four on Sunday night, and a total of 5 entire shots on goal for the entire four-game series. And that is how you play defense and lock up Ovechkin. I think the Rangers did a fantastic job matching up against him and just concentrating and shutting him down, because Ovechkin has been a Ranger killer in the past and not to be this year. The Rangers just were too good everywhere. Panarin, while he had 2 goals, he was a little bit absent, I'd say, from the middle parts of the series. He did have the goal in game one. He had a goal in game four. Not bad. He didn't play bad at all this series, but I would expect and hope for more in the next series. He was not, I would say, as good as the other stars of the show, meaning, what Trocheck did and Mika did, and even Chris Kreider to a point. I don't really think Panarin showed up that much compared to those big guns. So I want to see a little more out of Panarin in the next series. Still, it was good that he didn't get shut out. It was good that he got a couple points and a couple goals. Obviously, Adam Fox has been really good. Condre Miller has played really well. Even Schneider, the kid, has played really well on defense there. Not bad at all. Trouba, mostly okay. He had one horrendous giveaway in one of the last two games. But he's been mostly quiet. You know, he'll probably deliver some big hit in the next series that'll wake up the Rangers when they're losing or something. Critically for the Rangers, Igor Shesterkin has been absolutely solid, rock solid in goal, as he has been really since the All-Star break. He had a tough, tough stretch in the middle of the year where he was not playing well at all in goal. And somebody flipped a switch on him. Maybe it was the goaltending coach, Benoit Allaire. He's really renowned for helping goalies. Whatever it was, somebody flipped a switch, and Igor has been just dynamite for the last 2 or 3 months, and he had a really good series, very solid in goal. I mean, he didn't really stand on his head in any of the games, but he was extremely solid, made a few really big saves and big spots for the Rangers at the times when the game was tied or close in some of these games. Again, none of these four games were blowouts. None of them could the Rangers just sort of, you know, skate around on their own in the third period and not worry about anything. They were all close games. Which I think actually helps the Rangers. I wouldn't want to see them winning blowout games, because then I don't think, you know, iron sharpens iron, right? You don't want, you know, weak opponents, because then when you actually face a strong opponent, you're not prepared for it. And that's a little bit what happened with the Rangers-Devils last year. A lot of things happened, but they won the first two games in New Jersey in last year's first round really fairly easily, I would say. They won, I think it was 5-2, 5-1 in both of those first two games. And, you know, I don't think they were particularly sharp after that. The speed and skill of the Devil just ran all over them after that. And so the fact that the Rangers had to grind a little bit and try harder than it would seem they would have with a 4-0 series win is a benefit to them in the long term, right? I would not have wanted to see, you know, 5-1, 4-0, you know, 3-0. 6-2 games. I mean, obviously, I like those kind of games, but when it comes to the Rangers next series, the Rangers being sharp, the Rangers being forced to, you know, contend with a loud crowd in a 2-2 game late in the second, you know, being forced back in their own zone and being forced to make plays and score power play goals in big spots, you know, not when it's 3-0 and it's easy to score a power play goal, but when it's, you know, 2-2 with the crowd yelling against you with those stupid friggin' horns in Washington. All of that, I think, goes into play into building, you know, a team that can make a longer playoff run. Happening your iron, being sharpened by iron early in the series, I think really helps. Now, as far as other folks, you know, we're probably going to be facing Carolina in round two. Carolina is up 3-1 over the Islanders. Game 5 is on Tuesday night for Carolina, and if they win that or one of the next 3 games, any of the next 3, it'll be the Rangers against Carolina. And obviously, Carolina had the second best record in the entire NHL. The Rangers had the best record, and that earned them this trip against Washington, which I think is very, very helpful. It's going to be a much, much, much tougher series against Carolina. Carolina is much faster. They have much better goaltending than Washington did. Carolina is faster than the Rangers as a team overall. They play outstanding defense. There is not going to be much time to make passes. When the Rangers are on the power play, you're going to see a much different power play. It's going to be much harder to get passes around and much harder to get shots on goal. I think it's going to be quite an interesting series when the Rangers play Carolina. We have had success against Carolina in the past, but that doesn't really mean much in the NHL. Everybody knows that. It's going to be a much, much, much tougher test. And, you know, one thing that is good is when you have the President's Trophy in your back pocket and the most points in the league, what you get is home ice advantage throughout the playoffs. So when they face Carolina or whoever it is, everywhere until the Stanley Cup, if they get that far, the Rangers will have home ice advantage. So 4 games at their place as opposed to 3 in the first 2 of the series. So that's really something that you can kind of put in your back pocket and say, okay, you know, we're going to start at the Garden, first 2 at home, no matter who the opponent is. So there is one little thing maybe to talk about before I go on to the Yanks, and that's with how much time the Rangers are going to have off. The Rangers might have a week off between this last game, which was Sunday, And when the next round starts, maybe over the weekend, maybe even later, they haven't announced when round two is starting yet. And there's always this debate, and it's, you know, sort of titled rest versus rust. You might have heard it that way. And essentially, it boils down to a nice little saying that means, is it better for a team, especially in hockey, to get rest where there's a lot of injured players? And if you're an avid watcher of hockey, you know that people are hurt all the time and you never hear about it or see about it until after the playoffs. Oh, he was playing with a bruised thigh, a sprain this, you know, he had this kind of shot. A lot of times, you know, you see them laying down and blocking shots and all this other stuff that happens. They take hits after hits in the corner. There's lots of little nagging injuries. So having a week of rest for the Rangers, that is the plus side, right? So that's the rest part. Now, the negative is the rust part, right? You get rusty, right? Waiting a week and not doing anything versus playing a team that has, say, played a long 6 or 7 game series and one is now to face you. That team is sharp as a tack, right? They've had to be at their best every day, all day, in every game, and now they're playing you in game one and they are sharp and ready right from the puck drop. Whereas a team like the Rangers, who might have had a week off, it might be sleepy in the first game or so. So it rest versus rust is a real thing. And there's a pretty good debate going around. There's arguments on both sides, whether it's better to actually have that long off or how much time off is a good amount off, right? You certainly don't want every series to go seven. And the Rangers did that a couple years ago and kind of got worn down by Tampa Bay in the conference finals. 7 games against Pittsburgh, 7 games against the Carolina. Rangers won both of them, won the first two at Tampa Bay, and then lost, you know, the next four in Tampa. And that's all she wrote, basically. So it was kind of a, you know, falling apart at the end. So certainly you don't want to play all 7-game series. I'm not sure really if you want a week off, though. That almost seems excessive. So it is something to think about as we head into round two. Will they be a little bit rusty? Will they make any changes, right? We have Filip Hedl, who apparently is healthy now. He's missed just about all of the year with the concussions, and now he's been skating with the team for quite a while. Will they make a change against Carolina, who is a much, much faster team than Washington was, but not quite as big a hitting team as, you know, Tom Wilson and Washington? So while you want, you know, Rempe in there, in the Washington series, you may want, instead of Rempe, you may want to have Filip Hedl with all his speed as another really fast center to kind of combat some of the speed that Carolina is certainly going to throw us around too. So it's just something to think about. And really an excellent, near perfect first round series win by the Rangers over the Washington Capitals in the first round of the NHL playoffs. I'm going to go ahead and move on and talk about the Yanks. Go Rangers. Real quick, I just wanted to talk about the New York Yankees, who have somehow, some way, managed to actually score 15 runs in back-to-back games after really struggling at the plate most of the year. And I'm telling you, when I say struggling, I mean, this was like the past year's teams, right? We got Soto in the beginning. Everything looked great. We beat Houston on the road, 4-game sweep, set them down a struggling path. Oh, yeah, it's a different Yankee team. And then, you know, a couple weeks later, this is kind of the same Yankee team. They keep striking out. They keep failing with runners in scoring position. They keep, you know, not making contact. Like, what is happening here? And then finally, they break out. 15 runs in 2 straight games against Milwaukee, back-to-back games. That is really something. And the game before that, they scored a lot as well. So it was kind of a fun thing to watch. And it's good to see a lot of the Yankees somewhat getting back on track. We'll see if it holds up in what's going to be a big series starting on Monday night. The Yanks have really been struggling to score all year. They've been shut out 4 different times already this year, the Yankees. So, you know, I'm not making this up that the Rangers, that the Yanks are struggling. There was an interesting little bit in the last win where Judge slid into second on a double play attempt. And when the second baseman was trying to make the relay throw, Judge was like raising his hand like he's going to answer a question while he's sliding into second, and the ball hit his hand. And the umps basically said, it's all right, it's fine, no problem. I don't really know what to say about this. Judge claimed it's a natural part of his slide, and he says, you know, look back at all my slides. They're all like that. And, you know, maybe they are. I don't know. It just seems a weird thing to slide in that way and just hold your hand straight up in the air. Maybe it is something he does all the time. I don't really know. He might have to change that, though, because if he does that again and it hits him again, I think now that it's out there and in the ether, I think they're going to, take notice of this and call him against it. But it was kind of a funny thing. There were two outs in the inning, or there was one out. That would have made it two outs, and the next guy popped up. It would have been the end of the inning. But then the Yanks went on to get seven straight hits. They scored like six more runs that inning. The fans are all mad because, they didn't make that call. It was an interesting little aside. I don't know. It's interesting. I got to tell you, though, as a Yankee fan watching these last couple games, and it's not really about wins and losses because the Yankees have won a lot of this times this year, even when they're not hitting, because they've gotten pretty damn good starting pitching. It's so much better to watch a baseball team who can score runs, even if your team loses. It's so much better to watch the Yankees when they're actually scoring than it is to watch a team that loses 2-0 or loses 3-1. When you're watching the Yankees, even if they lose an 8-6 game or 10-9 game or anything, 6-5, something like that, it's a better experience. And no one wants to lose any games. And sometimes those games can even be harder on you, when it's very exciting and the other team gets one more run. But just trying to sit through a 2-0 loss or a 3-1 loss, it's really frustrating. And especially for what I would say, might be new baseball fans, if you're trying to get kids into the game or whatever, trying to sit through a 2-0 game where your team is losing, especially, is just tough. I mean, you have nothing to cling on to. Everyone's striking out. You're not getting any hits. You see another stat line for the Yanks. If I see another game in the Baltimore series where the Yanks have, no runs on four hits or something, or one run on six hits and they lose 4-1, like, it's just a tough experience. And it's really hard to, get into a game like that. And if you're a Yankee fan, now over the last couple of years, you're used to this problem with the Yanks not making contact, striking out too much, doing a lot. And this recent run of banging in the runs and getting all these hits is so refreshing to see. And it just makes baseball so much better. And again, I know they won, so that obviously contributes to it. But even the game that they lost, the opening game in the series to Milwaukee, where they lost, was it 7-6 or 8-7 in 10 or 11 innings? That sucked that they lost, and Boone sucks balls for all the moves he made in that game, but it's still so much better than losing a 2-0 game because they were in it. It was exciting. There's things to talk about. Your team gets no runs and four hits. What are you going to even talk about the next day? We suck. Nobody can hit. Like in this game, you can talk about all the runs that scored, all the runs that didn't score. Should Boone have actually left Holmes in for another inning? Answer, yes. Spoiler. But the bottom line is that it's just so much better to watch a team that can play on offense. And by the way, that translates to almost any sport. In today's day and age, I know that old timers like defense, but this pertains to hockey. This pertains to football for sure. And even basketball to a degree. A team that can score is an exciting team to watch. And it's something that, hopefully the Yanks can sort of capitalize here. And I think a big part of that is having all these lefties in the lineup. And if, Cabrera can keep hitting a little bit more than he's been, there's been some great stuff, especially from the lefties. And that's Verdugo, who has absolutely been great. What a pickup for the Yankees. Having him play an outstanding left field has been a joy to watch. He has a strong arm. He covers a lot of ground. He's a great hitter. He really is a great hitter. He's always been, a great hitter, and he's still a great hitter. He's lefty. He makes contact all the time. He almost never strikes out. He hits the ball to the opposite field. He plays really good defense. He has a really interesting personality, which I think is fun. I mean, he's a little showy, but the Yanks need some of that, screw you confidence that I think they've been lacking for now the last couple of years. They're too buttoned up in business like all the time. And I don't mean that, silly celebrations after a home run. Hey, whatever, jumps this, bottom five, high five, jump around, whatever. I could take or leave that crap. But just it's a general sort of confidence that he has, smiling that Verdugo has, and a fun way to really kind of go about the game. And I think it bleeds into other people on his team. And I think it really helps the Yanks as a team to have some of that shared confidence and swagger that in my mind the Yanks have been lacking for a couple of years now. They have not had a swagger in what is a really, really long time in my mind. And I think that, you know, it's important that the Yankees have this kind of swagger. Maybe, you know, having someone like Verdugo on the team will go a long way. I'm really tired of the buttoned up Yankees. That's the bottom line. So I like every single thing about Verdugo so far. Obviously, Juan Soto, another lefty, is ridiculously good. I mean, I don't even know what to say. I don't even want to waste time talking about him. He's so good, right? He's been really good in right field. People talked about, you know, maybe not as good a defender as others. I think he's been really good there. He's been obviously tremendous at getting on base. He hits the ball the other way. He gets big home runs. Even when everyone else is not hitting, he's hitting. He's just so good. Judge is finally coming out of his funk. Finally. It's taken him forever. But he's finally starting to hit. You know, knock on wood. We'll see in a couple days, in a week, if he's still hitting well. But he's made it all the way over the 200. You know, he's off the interstate, as they say, up into the 200. So that's something. Rizzo finally starting to hit. Another one, right? That's another real big, you know, big thing for the Yankees. It's huge. I've also liked how Trevino has hit, right? He's been a really good, you know, hitting catcher, making contact, hitting the ball the other way, getting some big hits. I have confidence in him when he's up at the plate, you know. Some of the others have recently been up and down. Volpe had that great start. He kind of came back down to earth a little bit, but lately he's been kind of getting back to hitting the ball the other way and doing some good stuff. So he's kind of in the middle. Same thing with Oswaldo Cabrera. Great start to the season. Has not hit all that much lately, but, you know, it's not terrible average, but certainly it's got to do a little better than he's been doing lately. Rodon, as far as the pitching staff, has been really good. Really good. Just about as good as we can expect. I'm very pleased with that. Nestor Cortes, pretty good start to the season. Stroman, I really enjoy as a starter. You know, he's not going to strike out 10 people every game, but he keeps the Yankees in every single game. And I like it. I know the last game he didn't have a great game, but he keeps the Yanks in the game, and that's fine. The same really for Schmidt and Heel. Obviously not quite as good, but Schmidt, I think, has been really, really a serviceable pitcher. It's hard to remember too many bad games from Schmidt over the last 2 years, honestly. You know, that people are quick to point out negatives about Schmidt. He doesn't go this many innings. He doesn't do that. And that's all certainly true, and I think almost every starting pitcher now has this problem with too many pitches per inning because they're so concerned with throwing a strike and getting hit that they're just nipping at the corners, you know. And so every at bat is 4, 5, 6 pitches. You know, they're quite worried about just, you know, letting the batter hit the ball and letting them ground out or pop up. You know, again, it's that old saying, the best hitters in baseball fail 70% of the time. So you know what? If you throw a strike, you know, there's a pretty good chance that the hitter's not going to get a hit. You know, more than 2 out of 3, they're not going to get a hit. And, you know, the ones that aren't great hitters, it's more than 3 out of 4, they're not going to get a hit. So I think pitching to contact needs to be a thing that gets back in baseball because all these starting pitchers just, you know, they don't go long enough. And with today's ridiculous management in baseball, you didn't just have the parade of pitchers coming in. So with all that in mind, I think our starting pitching has been just fine and even better than fine. Really, really good. I'm very happy with everyone. The negatives are my normal negatives, right? Torres suck balls in every way. You know, he had a few hits against Milwaukee, but screw that. He's been awful, awful at second base and just, you know, has not hit this year like he did last year. He was our second best hitter last year. This year he's hitting terrible, and you know, he's a disgusting second baseman, but that's always my thing. You know, the bullpen has been objectively terrible for the Yanks this year. I don't know what they did. Everyone always praises, you know, Cashman for what a great job he does in bringing in bullpen people. Not this year, Cashman. This bullpen is terrible. Terrible in every way. Boy, I cannot stand, you know, some of these people. Ferguson, what is with him? He just gets lit up left and right. Santana is not any good. There's a bunch of people that are not very good. Hamilton started well and now is having trouble. Clay Holmes is not as good as everybody makes him out to be. I'm not particularly thrilled with most of this bullpen. And, you know, the Yanks have found a way to win a fair amount of games in spite of that. And sometimes, you know, it's a matter of just letting the starter go longer, no matter how bad he is, because the Yanks always seem to get in the situation where the relievers are not available, right? Because of this stupid Yankee math that they have. He pitched two of the last 3 days, therefore he's unavailable, or whatever happy horseshit they do, right? But you need to sometimes lose a game in order to maintain the long-term, I guess, stability of your pitching staff. And that means just because a starting pitcher has a bad start does not mean you need to have 6 or 7 innings out of your bullpen. Sometimes let the guy get creamed, right? If we're losing 6-0 in the bottom of the third, 7-0, what is the chance we're really going to come back and win that game? Think about it. It's probably not very good, right? Maybe there's a chance, but still. So if we're going to lose the game and your starting pitcher is only at whatever, 50, 60 pitches, even 70, let him stay in there. So what if it becomes 8 or 9-0? Is that much worse than 7-0? So what? Let him eat up some innings. And then if you have to put the bullpen in after the 6th or 7th inning, you do it. But I'm sorry, we cannot continue to have a parade of bullpen lefty, righty, lefty, after every time a starting pitcher, you know, has a hiccup. And it's something that the Yankees do. And I think it's starting to get more prevalent about around baseball. But the Yanks are the worst offenders of this, where they just, you know, coddle these starters. And anytime they get anywhere near the 90 pitch mark, God forbid, and they have the littlest hiccup, that's it. You know, if it's the 4th inning, 5th inning, 6th inning, that's it. The rest of the game is relievers, and you have more of the game with relievers than the starter. I'm sorry, guys. For the long-term health of the team, you might have to lose a game, you know, that you somehow might have won, and keep your bullpen intact, rest them, and have them be available in critical situations when it's a 2-1 game in some other game, rather than having to bring them in when it's a 6-0 game. And who gives a shit if it's an 8-0 game at that point? Bottom line is, I think there's, you know, our starters have been good, but our starters I would like to see go much longer than they are. But a lot of that is sort of endemic to what's happening in baseball, you know, as a sport. Yankees do take on the Baltimore Orioles in a 4-game series, which is really exciting. It starts tonight. I'm recording this on Monday. Should be a very interesting 4-game series in Baltimore. Baltimore's right on our tails. It's great to score runs. Everything is better. Everything feels better. It's good to have the Yankees doing all that. And I'm a happy podcaster when the Yanks hit the ball. If they lose, I won't be as happy, but I will be much happier if they hit and lose than if they don't hit and lose. So here's hoping the bats stay hot and the Yanks take a few games from Baltimore. And that's it. Thanks for listening to Jersey Guy Sports. Please subscribe to the podcast. Tell your friends about it, and I will be back soon with some more sports talk. Thanks, have a good night.